On behalf of our entire crew here, I want to start by thanking Seth Birch, who has put all these together, does a whole bunch of the technical stuff, but also the design of the whole program, does all the reach out, as well as our chair, Mike Boyle, who helps with all this, helps to coordinate that, and up to our dean, who's often involved and maybe watching today, so watch yourself there, Derek, as far as how far you go, and even up to our presidential council and Dr. Fiorentino, because they're all involved in this and they're all pushing for it. So we've had a number of speakers come on over the past couple of months from various years, but I think we're going back a little further today. Not trying to make you feel old, Derek. Derek Frey is a graduate from 1995 from the communication, what was then just the communication program as opposed to the communication and media program that we have today. Welcome, Derek. Great to see you.
Thank you very much. Pleasure to be here. Thank you.
Where are we finding you today? Looks like a nice place.
I'm in beautiful Chester County, Pennsylvania. Yeah, been here the last year through the pandemic. We decided to kind of come back here. We were living in London, my family and I, and we thought, oh, there's going to be a bit of a shutdown for a few weeks. Maybe we'll come home, be near family. And here we are, like over a year later, like a lot of people, still kind of stuck in place. But hopefully things, you know, a ray of light coming and we'll be able to get out to the world soon.
What was a couple of weeks became a couple of months, became a year.
Exactly.
So far, yeah. But we're making progress. The sun is shining. You've had a long and this is, I'm going over your bio. This is a long and fascinating career. It's, you're circling back now in the great circle of things, but you've done a ton of stuff. But I wanted to start with we're talking about, where did you come from to get to Westchester?
Oh, I grew up in Delaware County from Upper Darby, went to Upper Darby High School. Upon grad, Westchester just seemed like a great fit. A lot of friends of mine had gone there. And a lot of my interest in music at the time, kind of music was the center mode, obviously, music program. So
but don't go by myself
to enroll in.
I'm also from Delco. We got a lot of Delco people out in Westchester.
Yeah, exactly.
I'm assuming you've seen the new films, the new Delco films of the mayor of Easttown.
I have not checked it out yet, but I've read a number of the reviews and it seemed to be getting a really good buzz.
It does, and it has all kinds of references to Riddle Hospital and all kinds of things will make you jump when they're so hyper local. And Delco seems to be getting its own branding these days. There's a lot of people proud of Delco. Let's talk about your earlier years, years at Westchester. Let's talk about your early time there. Did you come in as a comm major?
I came in as a communication studies major. Yes. Yes, I did. And I think a lot of my interest evolved, at least from my study level, more into journalism. Although they didn't have a journalism major there, that kind of became my interest. I took some courses in journalism and I interned at Channel 6 Action News. And that kind of was a trajectory I was on professionally. At the same time, I was involved heavily. I was a co-news editor at the Quad. I think I was news director at WCUR. And then also my senior year, they kind of ramped up what was WCU-TV, which had been dormant for a number of years. And there was a professor, I think he saw that myself and other students had an interest in like broadcast journalism. And they said, hey, we've got this center, you know, we've got this room over at the Bull Center. We've got cameras that are just lying over there. Do you guys want to start something? So we kind of, it was kind of great, just a handful of us pulled it together and started our own news program and talk shows. And throughout all this time, on the side, it was kind of a hobby of mine to make films. My friends and I made films throughout my years at Westchester, in the dorms, in South Campus, all around campus, in the woods, like pretty much everywhere. When we weren't studying, we were making movies. But that was really just a hobby of mine, something I did on the side. I never really saw filmmaking as something I could do professionally. I did think for a moment about maybe transferring to a university where I could maybe pursue a career or at least studies in filmmaking. But I kind of felt like I had everything I needed at Westchester. And another professor at the school he gave me the opportunity to use like an old video toaster system that a lot of the faculty was using for their own kind of use. He gave me access to that. So then I had something that I could actually properly edit my films on. He lent me a camera. So in a way, I kind of made my own filmmaking studies. And then as I approached my senior year, I had the opportunity to go to LA. And I couldn't believe there's this place where like the entertainment industry thrives. And all of a sudden, something that just seemed like a dream became something that could become a reality. So I was very fortunate. I really enjoyed my studies there, but then also all the extracurricular stuff and then kind of the hobby stuff of filmmaking. It all kind of came together my senior year. And then I had the opportunity to move to LA and landed a job there. So I was very fortunate.
That's a great success story. Now, you almost name dropped a couple of people. You want to give a shout out to any of those professors or any of those?
There were so many. Dr. Reed was someone that I took a couple of courses in filmmaking. And he was actually the one that kind of opened up the WCU TV facilities to a number of students.
Awesome.
The poster system lent me a camera. And then, you know, I think I can mention it now. Like, I made a film my senior year. Kind of like a horror movie on campus, and he gave me access to the underground tunnel. So that was kind of the biggest thing that he did for me. He gave me the keys. I'm not advocating for people exploring the underground tunnels at WCU, but that was like amazing that a professor, you know, gave a student access to shoot a film down there. So that was cool.
I think just the fact that you just revealed that there are underground tunnels is pretty intriguing for a lot of students. Now they have something to do when they get back in the fall. It's find the underground tunnels.
Hope I don't cause any problems.
So this let's call it a crew. This crew you put together. These are other Westchester Comm students or Westchester people your year or years around you.
Yeah. Again, you know, my closest friends. We're all through the music department. You know, we all came in. We're in band. We were band kids. And I think, you know, it kind of goes with the territory, you know, when you have that kind of creative flair and interest in music and film. And, you know, I think we all just had interest in kind of picking up a camera and doing things creative outside of our curriculum. So it was definitely like a combined effort. Like, you know, I wouldn't say like, you know, in a lot of the projects, it wasn't like me as the director. It was like all of us just creating. You know, it wasn't about roles. It was just about doing something fun. Like, and we weren't really like the party types. We weren't out like drinking and partying. We were basically staying in Goshen Hall and roaming around the hallways and making movies. So, you know, nerds, I guess. We were kind of nerds. But.
Well, that's wonderful. You've got this combination of people, plus you're doing the band, plus you're doing the quad. Plus, you're doing that. Did you sleep, or was it just?
No, I didn't sleep. Anybody knows me knows I don't sleep very much, and you know, you just kind of it just kind of fuels you when you have creativity driving you. So I definitely was pushing myself to the limit at that time.
That's wonderful. That's wonderful.
It was exhilarating. It was exhilarating. Yeah.
That's wonderful. But you didn't really do it as a, this person was cameraman. This person was producer. I mean, you must have had people co-writing and.
No, if anybody watches those movies, it's very clear. You know, a couple of my friends are actually very good actors, but like if you see me in a role, it's not because I thought I could act. It's because I was the only one willing to commit as much time to my own kind of ideas. So, you know, I moved off of those things as soon as I could. But yeah, definitely a collaborative effort.
I'm assuming you've still got copies of these. You ever go back to them?
Yeah, anyone that knows me, I'm like very nostalgic. I keep everything, and you know, those things are still very close to me, and they mean something to me, you know. So, you know, absolutely, I keep everything.
That's wonderful. That's wonderful. We have some Delco viewers on our broadcast today. They want to know about how much of your childhood and growing up in Drexel Hill actually impacted your professional career. Did you bring any of that with you?
My professional career, absolutely. It's still something very close to my heart. And you know, growing up in Delco, I don't know about most people, but for me, like, going to the movies, you know, was something from when I was a child. You know, my parents, my grandparents, like, it was almost like I felt like a weekly event. And being a kid in the late 70s, early 80s, I think you find a lot of people involved in the film industry now, they were going to films during that period. You know, Spielberg was making amazing films and fantasy and Star Wars and Indiana Jones. Like, those things had a big impact on people my age. And I think being in Delco and going to the movies was a big thing back then. So it's something that I keep very true to my heart. I still collaborate with a number of my friends that are in a comedy troupe, the Minor Prophets. They're all from Delco. A number of them went to Westchester. And we make like a film or two every year, and they're usually made in Delaware County. So you know, even when I've been living in London most of the last 15 years, whenever I'm back here on a holiday or for summer break, Christmas break, we get together and we collaborate and we make something. And those stories are all, if you've seen any of them, they're all very true. And you see a lot of familiar places within Delaware County. So
awesome. Awesome.
Absolutely. Not only was it something inspiring me to me then, it continues to be an inspiration to me.
Did you go to the Waverly?
Oh, yeah. All the time.
Used to be a dollar. It was a dollar.
I know. I think I saw one of my first rated R movies. I think I may have seen like Caddyshack there when I was very young. But back then, people didn't, you know, the ratings were a little more flexible and you just went to the movies a lot. But yeah, the Waverly was within walking distance.
I know it well. Now, you were doing all this kind of collaboration at Westchester and it was resulting in a film. Did anything start to jump out at you or emerge as this is where I find myself in film?
Well, my junior year at Westchester, I had the opportunity to visit LA, and that's when I got my first taste of it. And I was like, wow, this place is amazing. It's all, you know, entertainment based. Then my senior year, with like a lot of encouragement from friends and family and even some of the faculty at Westchester, like I made that movie. And, you know, when you're making a movie, you think it's like the greatest thing that's ever been made. And, you know, we had a big premiere at Schmucker Auditorium, and you know, the reaction to that really emboldened me to make a move to LA and pursue. And I thought, well, look, I'll go to LA, and if in a few months nothing's working out, I'll come back and I'll dive into journalism somewhere. Go work at WPBI or find a job, because you know the news business is a big deal in Philadelphia. You know, it's kind of like the big broadcast event in Philly. So I thought I had nothing to lose, and I took a chance. And then after a few months of not finding anything, I did land my first job there, and then it just kind of took off from there. So absolutely, like I feel like my senior year, what was a hobby, kind of began to kind of drive my trajectory and my career path.
But that's a bold move from Schmucker presentations to just going all in and going to LA.
Yeah. When you're young, you're naive, you know, like I wish I still carried some of that with me now, because when you're young, I feel like you take those chances. And I feel like when you do, the rewards can be really incredible. You know, if you have, you know, the drive and the patience, and it does take a little bit of luck too. You know, I consider myself very fortunate that I had people that helped me out and guided me. And, you know, that plays a big hand in these things.
That's great. And I'm sure you're doing the same for other people as they come along and come in your path behind you. You were out there as for an internship?
No. I literally, my internship was while I was at Westchester.
Okay.
I worked at WPBI for a summer, which was incredible.
Yeah. Okay, so you were out there cold.
I was out there cold, yeah. Yeah, I had made some contacts the previous year, and they all were like, great, like when you come, if you move out here, give us a call, we'll see what's going on. I did that, and everyone's like, oh, nothing's going on right now. But then eventually it did lead to a job. I worked at, it was called the Entertainment Industry Development Corporation. And it was actually the company that files all the permits for filming in LA County. So I literally was doing data entry for films that were going to film in the county and basically processing their permits. And then after a month or two, a position opened up on an ABC production sitcom at the Paramount Studios lot. They were looking for like a runner, like a production assistant. And the person at the Entertainment Industry Development Corporation had suggested me for that position. I interviewed, and that kind of was my first official job, like kind of within the industry, you know.
So data entry was your foot into the business?
Kind of, yeah, kind of for a short period, yes.
Yeah, we have students here who are like you were considering big moves and how daunting that is. If you could, in super slow-mo, take us through the agonizing times of not knowing what was going on and did I make the right decision? I hate to focus on that time, but it's an important thing for students to hear about.
No. It was a tremendous challenge. And like, for instance, like LA is like a big city. And the first thing I'm doing there is like navigating the city, you know, in a time before smartphones, you know? So like a lot of the job is like delivering scripts and like you're doing all the grunt work, you know? At the same time, it was incredibly inspiring because it's exciting. It was a weekly sitcom. So the pace of things was very fast. The people are all very creative. And I was very fortunate to land with a lovely professional group of people who really respected and were appreciative of the work that, you know, the lower level production assistants were putting into the show. So I felt incredibly fortunate and also inspired because although my goal was to work in film, this was a sitcom. Television was different back then. Now television, it's as equal to movies, right? Like you watch television and these things are epic. Back then, there was a bit more of a divide, like, oh, you're working in TV versus you're working on a movie, you know? So I felt that for a moment, like a little bit like, oh, like, wish I was working on a movie. But then it was at the Paramount Studios lot. So, you know, you walk around the lot and there are a number of Star Trek TV shows filming at that time. And to see these characters walking around the lot or to see all these other big TV shows and movies going on, it was incredibly inspiring. So I think the pace of things was so fast that I never felt down or like I was really up for the challenge. And I've always kind of fed off of hard work. And all I would say is I think a lot of people, at least in LA, they walk into the industry and maybe they've studied film for 4 years and they feel like they come into it with a lot more knowledge. And then they expect they're going to be put into a position that's maybe a little higher than doing all the grunt work. I think for me, something that was positive is that I hadn't studied film. So I had an interest in it. It was a hobby, but I didn't really have any expectations on what to expect or what I should be doing. I was happy to be getting coffee for the writers. I was happy to just kind of be able to sit in and listen and absorb what it was they were doing. You know, I didn't really expect like I'm going to be sitting in the chair doing that work. I was happy to kind of facilitate and learn. And I think if you come in with, you know, that patience and you put in the time and the work, I think there's a bit of a passage, you know, to getting to where, you know, you want to go and what you want to be. So, I do feel like the patience that I had and the perseverance was something that ultimately paid off.
That's awesome that the grind was kind of necessary for you. It was part of your education that way.
Yes.
Can I ask you about something separate at the time? I'm trying to, are we talking about like you walking around these, like how we think of a big lot, like, you know, hangers and wardrobe going by and boom mics and all that stuff?
I'll tell you, like, and again, it may have been just me being new to it all, but like, it really felt like to me every day, like that idyllic representation of what it's like to be on a movie studio. Paramount Studios has such a history, such a beautiful lot, and the productions that were going on at that time, it really was that kind of thing you see in movies, like the behind the scenes.
Yeah.
It was, for me, coming from Pennsylvania, I could never have dreamed that I'd be in LA working on a studio lot like that. So for me, it was incredibly inspiring, and it kind of, it made when days were hard, maybe, and challenging and long, you just kind of always take a step back and realize like how amazing an experience it was.
That's really exciting. That's really exciting. But the part that I was going to ask you about was it all work, or did you start to develop a social scene and make friends and things like that?
It was work, but a lot of the friends that you make are within those work circles. So I think I carried a lot of my, you know, work ethic and my hobby of making films to LA. So if I was really never a part of the social scene of LA or going out in LA. So when I wasn't working, I'd be making my own films in LA with people and friends that I was making there. So it, you know, my challenge was to make each film just a little bit more, you know, a little better. You know, whether it's technically or the writing or the acting, like just try to see a progression in the work that I was doing. So in LA, I had a little more access to professionals that could maybe help that journey a bit and maybe bring a little more production design to something, or maybe hire an aspiring actor to play a role in something. So that was really nice to keep the filmmaking as a side project, aside from what I was doing professionally, but then have access to things that were maybe bringing things to another level.
So while you were doing whatever you were doing, you were still making films?
Yes.
That's exciting. Yeah. And that seems like it would be a natural way to build your connections, not interpersonal and friends as well as professional, just having that group of people that are outside of work as well as inside of work.
That's right. That's exactly right. And you know, basically in the industry, like, everybody there, like they're all creative minded people and they all have their personal, a lot of people have their own personal projects that they're doing. So it felt a little easier to find a pool of people to kind of go along and try to make your dreams a reality.
That's wonderful. That's wonderful. And I'm you were on how long were you on the television show?
We lasted one season before it was canceled, unfortunately. We had some pretty stiff competition at other networks. So I guess that whole journey was maybe 6 or 8 months. And then, you know, we were kind of waiting to see if we were going to get renewed for the next season. And then we got the news that we weren't being renewed. And fortunately for me, someone at the network at ABC knew that I had an interest in films, that eventually I wanted to work on a film production. And they knew someone that worked at Tim Burton Productions, and they were looking for like a runner, like a production assistant at Tim Burton Productions. And I remember that I got a call from the woman at ABC, and she was like, you know, would you be interested in interviewing for a job at Tim Burton Productions? And I was just like I was a huge fan of Tim's. Anyone that knew me in high school and college, like, I was kind of obsessed, you know. So when I heard that, like, I could interview for a job there, I was just like floored. But then also naive, like I think I felt the world was very small in LA. I realize now how lucky I was for that someone would make that connection and I'd have the opportunity.
So a lot of us would like to or think that our career projection is like this, and it ends up being like this.
Yes. Yes.
And things lead in directions where you don't normally see them.
You never know. And you can't really predict. And there, especially with a trajectory in the film industry, people always ask me about that trajectory. And what I always say is, you know, overnight success, yeah, it can happen, but it could take 10, 15, 20 years before you have that overnight moment, right? So there is no one way. There is no formula at all. I think you really have to let your passion and at least for a, you know, an area like filmmaking, you have to let your passion and your creativity kind of drive you. And then hopefully that path will kind of reveal itself for you.
That's great. By the way, the the Drexel Hill question came from your old neighbor, Scott Lanford.
Oh, geez. Yeah. All right.
He's on here, so just so you know that.
That's great.
And we're also going to question, do you still have your original laser?
Oh, yeah. No, I don't think I do. And now I'm pretty nostalgic, but I think I've lost track of it over the years, unfortunately.
A lot of changes, I'm assuming. I know you're not a grizzled veteran. I'm getting there, but you're a lot of changes, technological, a lot of changes going on as far as new things coming on and the entire growth of gaming, things like that. Can you talk to us a little bit about how the industry has changed while you've been there in reflection of digital media, gaming media, et cetera, different platforms?
Yeah, right now we're going through a tremendous change, through COVID. I think, theater going, I don't know if I'd go as far to say it's been struggling, but it's definitely been challenging for it to find its place in this day and age, especially in the last 10 or 15 years. And then now with COVID, it's really put a strain on film going. And I think for people like me, you make films for people to be able to go and experience in the theater, to see it on the biggest screen possible, to immerse yourself in a big room and just lose yourself. And I don't think the home experience completely transports you to that place. But we have to deal with the reality that people are at home. People have families. Going to the movies isn't as cheap as it used to be. So you have to create content that can be seen at home and also be seen in the theater. So it is a challenge because I still believe in the power of film and that it's unlike any other kind of entertainment that's out there. But, there's a new generation that's coming up. They're used to watching things on a phone, on an iPad. They're used to gaming or that blend between gaming and VR or any kind of other entertainment that's immersive. So I'm not sure where films are going to land. I do hope that the film going experience rebounds post-pandemic. I know a lot of theaters are struggling, they're shutting down. But I know personally, I can't wait to get back into the theater. I can't wait to be able to have that experience again. That being said, although I may look at watching a movie on a phone may not be necessarily the best thing for the film industry, the fact that young people now can make a movie on a phone, that's pretty amazing. Like if I had the technology that's available now when I was going to Westchester, like if you saw some of my movies now, you'd have a trouble getting through them because they're hard to watch because of the quality of them. If I had that access to technology now to have 4K video and be able to edit it on my phone, I think, there'd be no limit, to what I could have achieved back then, So yeah, so it's kind of a double-edged sword, and I think it's going to level out, but I think there's a lot of questions right now coming out of the pandemic on where entertainment's going to land. Like, are people just going to be at home? Or are they going to get back out into the world and see things in a public forum? I don't know the answer, but I hope there's room for everything.
So the Wonder Woman distribution deal, that was that rocked the industry, I'm assuming, with the bypassing the theaters.
Absolutely. I'm actually working for Warner Brothers right now on a film. And, it was something that I definitely questioned because I want the movie that I'm working on to be released in the theater. And by all accounts, it will be. It's still a few years away. But that was a big stance. But I understand the situation that a studio is in. They can't just withhold the content. The pandemic is continuing. And I think they're starting to see numbers that are coming in that show, yeah, there can be a world where you can release stuff to streaming and still bring people back into the theater. So I think it will be something in the middle of the two. And I think they're just really dealing with reality. And although it's a tough pill to swallow for a lot of filmmakers, I think we have to remain open to that being kind of a a trajectory of how entertainment will be released, at least in the near future.
Interesting. You're talking right now, and I can hear it in your voice. You're talking right now to aspiring filmmakers. You're talking to people. So whatever advice you can give them now, as far as technology or some kind of any kind of career advice, something they have ideas. We have a question from a faculty member who says, my teenage son is constantly coming up with ideas for movies. Some of them are good and I'd watch them. What do you suggest you do next with those ideas? Where do you go from idea to movie?
Yeah, well, I think it really depends on where the interests are. If it's storytelling, if it's writing, you have all the means to be able to write things down. And if you're like maybe a little older and you want to really pursue how to write a screenplay, there's resources out there, like resources that weren't available to me, when I was going to college. So I think there's a means to everything. I think for me, my main interest was always like a camera. I always liked a camera in my hand. I like recording things. I liked kind of catching beauty and I still do. I always have a camera near me. I'm always taking photos. So that's what kind of drove me. And then the story bits kind of filled in behind that. So I think it's really about what drives you creatively initially. But right now, there's nothing to hold you back from being able to create anything on your own. So it's really incremental steps of kind of diving into the filmmaking process, whether that's, putting a camera in your hand or writing down words to a story. I think there's limitless possibilities now. For me, I just kind of utilized what I could. I'd borrow a friend's VHS camera. I would, have two VCRs and edit between two VCRs. I mean, it was really a struggle, but back then it was exhilarating and it taught me the fundamentals of that process, as rough as they were at the time and crude. Now you don't have to worry about any of that crudeness. You can make something look seamless, So that's all I would say is, if you have that impulse to create, there's really nothing to hold you back. Like if you have a phone, you can do it all on your phone nowadays. It's crazy.
Wonderful. Right. And the university is progressing as well. We have a Dub-C Film Festival that's been very successful. We've had some great momentum in that. And we have the studios over there that you're always welcome to come back and wow and say, wasn't anything like this when I was back here in the old days, but we're always invited to come back and do that stuff. So you're on and on. How many years exactly were you in L.A.?
I was in L.A. for, each project kind of takes you somewhere else. So, if you're to add up the amount of years, I'm not sure, but I was basically based in L.A. for, I think, 8 or 10 years. And then I moved to London on a project for post-production and ended up kind of staying there. But again, each film takes you somewhere else in the world, and then you spend a year or two in another part of the world. But basically moved from Westchester, from Pennsylvania, to L.A. for 8 years, and then London for 15, and then now back here this past year because of the pandemic. But I'm due to move to Vancouver this summer for work on this new project. So,
wow, yeah. Wonderful. Tell us about the London time. Tell us about the projects and what you were doing on.
Well, I was continuing to work for Tim Burton Productions. And the projects that I, was based in London for the most part were films that I had a producer role in. I started as associate producer to executive producer to producer. So, I think the first one, we edited Big Fish in London. We had filmed in Alabama. And then we made Corpse Bride, Charlie and the Chocolate Factory, Sweeney Todd, Dark Shadows, Big Eyes, Miss Peregrine's Dumbo. Some of those were made in other cities around the world, but basically that was the hub for like post-production and to make those films in and around London. So, yeah.
I do hear kind of a dark theme in a lot of those.
Oh, yeah. Well, it's Tim Burton, which, I think that's one of the reasons I really was just thrilled to have the opportunity to work with him, because I always felt I identified with his films, and they're definitely in my zone of what I like, you know, the things that I like to watch and the kinds of stories I like to tell. So,
but you don't seem like a dark guy. You seem like an optimistic guy.
Yeah. People always say that to me, but if you knew me, you know, my interests are kind of off kilter. So,
and some of the dark stuff that Burton does actually has a very positive tone to it.
It does. It absolutely does. And I think my mom is watching. My mom used to be always concerned about the films I made at Westchester because she said, why does everybody die in them? Like, what, is there something wrong? Like, why does everybody die? So.
But now your mom is going to have to admit that you're being brought back as an expert from your former university. So something must have worked out.
She was always incredibly encouraging and you know, the always, you know, always very encouraging and, you know, has persevered through me being all over the world and her stressing it out about me and how I'm doing, if I'm getting enough sleep, if I'm eating right, but no, it's all good.
But I'm sure she's constantly named my son, the filmmaker.
I don't know.
What's the difference between an associate producer and a producer and an executive producer?
That's a whole other conversation. It you know, it's different from project to project. You know, some producers are people that brought an idea for a story to a studio, sold the rights. Other ones are people on an independent film that front the money. You know, my producerial roles have very much in my working relationship with Tim Burton, it was like kind of supporting his vision and being a communicative device, like a person who helps make sure that his vision is coming through. And then you're also dealing with the communications with the studio, making sure that their needs and wants are being voiced and just kind of helping that process through, you know. And I think with each role, you know, the responsibilities kind of grow and you become more of like the central producer on the project. So definitely with each project, kind of my responsibilities would grow. And an incredible journey.
It does sound like an incredible journey. Do you feel like you're in the spot where you want to be in terms of that massive complex process? Do you feel like this producer role is the right one for you?
I love it. I love it. You know, I just love creating. I love being part of that process. I love being collaborative. I enjoy helping others see their vision through. I still have my own personal interests, personal projects. I still personally love to direct my own things, but the producer level, you know, with the studios and these bigger movies, like I've really enjoyed it, and I feel like it plays a lot to my strengths because you have to kind of be. I think some of the best producers are kind of split minded. You have to be highly organized. You have to have a flair for creative, but you also have to be very practical and very organized. So I feel like my left and right brain mind is well suited for a producer role.
A lot of people lean heavily one at the expense of the other.
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. And it also, you know, you're part of a big puzzle. You know, it is a highly collaborative effort. And it's also a business too. So that's the thing. Like even with you know, the people that I've worked with, like great creative minds, they still have the sense that this is a business. So although you want to go out on that creative ledge and you want to create something that's pure to your own vision, you have to take into account the fact that like this is going to be seen by the masses, hopefully. And there is a bottom line and there's other forces, other studios that are actually footing the bill for all this. So it's a lot of responsibility, but as when I started in this industry, I kind of like to let the creative be the lead. And then, you know, so far everything else kind of falls into place and you find your way through it.
That's great. The films that you've been mentioning do seem to have a foot in each camp where they do involve some really unusual creative activity, but they weren't commercial successes.
Yes. Look, you know, every film is a bit of a, a challenge and you never really can predict what's going to land. Some films I've worked on critically not received well, but then the box office, like people go and watch it or vice versa. Nobody sees it, but then it gets great reviews. So, you know, it can be a mixed bag, but I think as long as you're proud you know, also some of the films I've worked on that maybe weren't successes were incredible, incredible experiences making the film. Like some of my best experiences of making a film didn't maybe equate to what was received very well. So, you know, you get something out of every project. It's always a different experience and rewarding in different ways.
Interesting. Interesting. So somebody in your business is constantly having people come up to them. I've got the script. I want to be where you are. How do I get into the business? I mean, that happens in every industry, but it really happens in your industry.
Yes.
So there are people watching this right now who are thinking that. They're thinking, I've always had this idea. I think this would make a great movie. I could be an actress. I love camera work. All different parts of it. Or the whole thing, like you're doing. Can you please talk to them?
Yeah. Look, all I would say is, and it's been my approach always, is like, get to it. Like don't wait for somebody else to unlock a key. Like just start creating. Create by any means you can find, you know. Even if it's at your home, on your phone, as I mentioned, like just get to it. Like, although professionally I'm helping create larger films, I still and hopefully will always continue to kind of pick up a camera on my spare time and create my own little things, because I have that need, and I feel like it's a real therapeutic kind of process after working on like a big major film to be able to have the flexibility to just create something on my own terms, completely on my own means, without deadlines and dealing with budgets and schedules and release dates. Like, you know, so that's all I would say is like, it starts with the creative process. And right now there's really nothing to stop you from diving into that, even if it's on a personal level.
That's great. And again, this is coming to us, folks, from a guy who sat where you sat, in the same chairs, some of the same dreams, some of the same doubts, right? There are doubts along the way.
Oh yeah, absolutely. You know, I do try to stay positive with everything, but I'm always trying to look forward and what is next. But again, like I'm very deeply nostalgic, so I think it's important to remember where you came from, so that you appreciate where you are. So that's something I've always held true, and Westchester's always been a real key to that, because I feel like that's where things really took a foothold creatively for me. So
that's great. That's great. Can we get you involved in the Dub C film series? Can we get you involved as a judge for that?
Let me know what you need. Sure. Sure.
Wow. Wonderful. We appreciate people who reach back. We appreciate that. Have to ask you what your favorite movie is.
Ooh, that is a good question.
Come on, you've been asked that one.
Yeah, and it's tough because I there's a lot of films that I love. You know, if you had asked me 5 years ago, I would have probably said Vertigo. But one that I keep coming back to, I think it's because of the time that I saw it, was Close Encounters. I was young when I saw that, and it just has always stuck with me. And I realized the things I'm still fascinated with, a lot of it connects back to that film. And I'd say Close Encounters. What an amazing film. They don't make them like that anymore.
It was grand. It was large. Yeah. And among the movies that you've worked on, which are you most proud of?
Oh, that is also a very difficult question. You know, again, this is talking about the experience of making films. The experience of making Big Fish was like an extraordinary one. We were in Alabama for 6 months, and every day, like if you watch that film, it's like kind of like a series of dreams. It's very like,
oh, yeah.
And making the film was a very similar kind of experience, where every day was a different location with different characters, a different premise. And when I look back at that time of making that film, it was just extraordinary. And the people that I met, and then having that film be received so well, and it's something I think as people continue to look back on it, it means something to them. So the combination of the experience of making that film and then seeing how it resonates with people now, I'd have to put that as one that I'm particularly proud of. But they're all, you know, although, you know, I didn't direct those films, they're all, you kind of all feel like they're your children in a way. So you love them all, you know, even for their faults. That's a really tough question. Yeah.
That's a very good answer though. getting a question on our chat. Did you know Matthew McGrory during your time at Westchester?
I did. I didn't know him at Westchester. I knew of him, and I remember very specifically because I did like work study at the library, and I remember him coming in and out of there. I remember him on campus, but I didn't know him. But then when we were doing the casting for Big Fish, his name came up for the giant. And I couldn't believe. And I remember telling Tim, like, hey, I know this guy. Like, he's got the right look. We should meet with him. And we met with him in Los Angeles at the Culver Studios. We did a little photo shoot with him. And he became the giant in Big Fish. We ended up hanging out in Alabama. Like, this is what I'm talking about. This is one of those experiences where, you know, kind of art imitating life, like someone from my personal life, from my university. And then we're working on a film together, and he's like this fantasy character in a Tim Burton movie. Extraordinary. Extraordinary.
Isn't that strange? Isn't that something? Doesn't it being a small role in the
amazing end? Amazing guy. And I'm so happy, you know, he left this planet too soon, but for him to have, you know, to be forever in a movie like Big Fish, and what a lovely role and what a memorable part. It's moving to me, you know?
Wonderful. So when you make a movie, or even as you learn about movies, you must look at them differently than just a movie buff. You must look at the construction, and you must be thinking about them in a very different way.
I do, but I still challenge myself to be able to strip that back and become immersed. So I think some of the best films that I experience now are ones that I end up not thinking about those things. And I feel like they're few and far between these days, but like when I can sit down and actually be transported and not think about, well, how did they do that shot? But yes, like personally, I've always loved that, like from a very early age, being a film buff, I've always wanted to ask those questions and pick apart things, because I think you then appreciate the film on a whole different level. But I still want to be transported on a level where you're not thinking about those things. So it becomes harder as you learn more about the process.
So you go do a 12-hour day at work, and then you go to the movies.
Sometimes I haven't gone to the movies in over a year, but I hope to be able to go back there soon. But yes, and also before I had kids, I'd go to the movies a lot more. That becomes harder too when you have kids.
Are you starting to move into that whole giant subgenre of children's films and all?
Yeah. But what's great is the film that I'm working on now will be something that my kids, I know they're going to enjoy. And they're actually starting to see the pieces come together. And so they're a very helpful audience for me at this early stage. Like I show them everything, and my six-year-old's a really good critic. So he's actually giving some ideas that we're putting into place. So that's been really amazing.
You got to be the cool dad when you go to What Does My Dad Do and bring him into class.
Yeah, not when I'm working 12-hour days. Oh, when's this going to be over? Oh, you got three more years of this, Dad.
Yeah. How'd they do it? How'd the Oscars people do this year in their choices?
Well, I have to say, as someone who's in the industry, it's kind of a responsibility to watch as many movies, to be a part of that process. This year, I don't know if it's because of the pandemic and the kids are at home, and then my work is this all day, I really didn't get a chance to watch as many movies as I would have liked to. But the ones that I felt were rewarded the most were ones that I did watch, and I felt like they were good choices. So although if you watch that ceremony, that was something else. I mean, I guess they're trying to make the most of a challenging situation, but it was quite a surreal and different experience this year from Union Station in Los Angeles.
That's a very different setup for it. Doug, we're running out of time here. Is there any last words you have for our viewers and listeners?
No. Thank you for your patience. If you're watching, sorry if I had to duck out technology these days, but a real pleasure and honor to be able to talk to you today and reflect a bit on my time at WCU. Again, if anybody knows me, like, you know, I'm always posting photos from my time there. Like, it's really close to my heart. So to be able to catch up today has been a real pleasure.
Thank you. And those who want to get in touch with you, how can they reach you?
Well, I'm on Facebook. I've got a website, laserfilm.com, laser with a Z.
L-A-Z-E-R.
L-A-Z-E-R-F-I-L-M.com. You can see some of my movies there. And I think you can email me through there too. So, and there's my look. There's, you're asking about the movies. There's a poster from the film I did.
Look at that. And it's free.
And there it is. See what evil lurks below WCU. So don't go into the tunnels.
Is that on the site? Is that coming?
Yeah.
Oh, now you got all kinds of beer. Your hit rate's going to go way up today.
Watch some of my more current ones, but yeah.
We really thank you for your time. We really thank you for your insight and your appreciation of your alma mater. It's really great to talk with you, and I think this has been very, very helpful to our to all of our different kinds of participants out there. So thank you very much.
Thank you. I appreciate it. Take care.